Hey guys, it's Matt here. I am rewriting a screenplay per usual, and we're gonna see if we can find things that are easy to rewrite on it. Exterior, mansion, front yard. Done. Sam Parker, 29. Let's fix this spacing. Handsome, shaved. Probably means clean shaven. That is a word that means a lot of different things in a lot of different contexts. Walks through an open gate. His knuckles are bloody. Same goes for the chain wrapped around his right hand. Alright, cool. So he's holding a chain like some bloody knuckles. That's potentially interesting. He exits a lavish front yard of what used to be a mansion, but is now nothing for... I think you could make this a cleaner image, like, behind him, the remains of an opulent mansion burn in the background. It starts raining. The rain washes the blood off of Sam. He walks away like a zombie, straight out of the Night of the Living Dead. An echoey kind of blank and deep voice is heard whispering. We could make this more specific. Begins to rain rivulets of water. Wash the blood off of Sam's hands. Starts raining, echoey, kind of blank and deep voices heard whispering. I told you so. Feet. Suddenly a terrifying creature appears walking next to Sam. Parasite. 7 feet 5 inches tall, thin long limbs, its skin grayish to pale like a corpse. It has a blank white mask embedded to its face with nothing but darkness behind the eye holes. Okay, we're probably gonna have to unpack that. Okay, I don't think we need the zombie walk. An echoey, kind of blank and deep voice. The voice in Sam's head is dispassionate and ominous. Sam reacts to it. Beat. And suddenly a terrifying creature appears walking next to Sam. Let's not give it a name just yet. This is Parasite. Something like that. And suddenly a terrifying creature appears next to Sam. 7 feet tall, thin, long limbs, its skin... That's not grammatically correct on skin pale like a corpse. You just want to get the images more immediate. I don't know what a blank white mask embedded into a face looks like. It's like the flesh growing around it. Hey Brian, how you doing? Any thoughts on Twitch versus YouTube? That's where I'm at. It has a blank white mask embedded to its face with nothing but darkness. Rather than a face, actually no. Its face is covered. God damn, let me versus my keyboard. Is covered by a blank white mask that seems to be embedded into the flesh of his skull. The flesh around his skull. Skull, no discernible. That's awesome about your drone racing script. What movie is it most like that already exists? Like the pod race scene in Star Wars was definitely a rebuff of Ben-Hur. No discernible eyes beneath the eye holes. Parasite, I told you, it feels so much better when you just let it out. Alright, that line is actually better than Parasite's intro line. So rather than have him say a boring thing and something that's kind of interesting, let's up the ratio of Parasite's usage. Yeah, sure, Brian. Send me the script and I'll take a look at it next. You have my email. I told you, it feels so much better, but blah, 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 blah. So now Parasite gets this line. And what I'd want to check in with next is... Sam spins to face Parasite. Is angry. He's angry. It's you. I'm here because of you. The burning house. Everything. It's all you, not me. That's not exactly great dialogue. I don't know. It's how would one read that? It's all you. I'm here because of you. The burning house. Everything. It's you, not me. It's all you! I'm here because of you! The burning house, everything! It's all you, not me! I don't know. Rather than give Sam a line that leaves it himself open to mockery, why don't we just cut this out? Rather than give him just an angry little rant, which sounds a little pissy and titchy, let's just cut directly to the action. Sam ignores Parasite for a moment, then suddenly swings his chain like a whip. The Parasite catches the chain and wraps its hand, that's not the possessive its, that is a contraction its, which stands for it is, so you don't want to do that. Sam is now eye to eye with his worst nightmare. Sam tries to free himself and gasps for air. These are present progressives, hate those. And fights for air. It hurts me, Sam, looking at you, how weak you've become, how you've succumbed to the way of the weak. Alright, I don't... you wouldn't want to double up weak and weak here. Even a generic line like, I had such high hopes for you, would probably be a little clearer. So then we cut to 3 days ago. Alright, if we're juxtaposing Sam... ages ago with Sam now, you might want to illustrate a clearer illustration of how he's changed. For example, if When we meet Sam, he's scruffy and furious and mean. And then beforehand, he's just like Mr. Rogers, boy next door. It sort of implies that there was a huge shift in his character over the 3 days up until the interesting incident we're opening up on. I'm just saying. Sam's room is dusty. There's a bed in a closet in it. Nothing more. Sam sits on the floor. His eyes are somewhat red. On the bed sits Sam's terrifying roomie, who Sam named Parasite, who gnaws on his sanity nonstop. I kind of feel like this would be more interesting if we didn't just start with the generic action scene opening. And it's actually more interesting to me to see a guy go about his business, you know, take the bus, go to work, make photocopies, run to Starbucks for the office, as he's just studiously ignoring this horrific lurking monster that is next to him. But that's just me. Where are we in chat? Alright. So, I feel like this is an intriguing opening, and the thing to explore more of would be the fact, like, what's inherently interesting to me is not that a man has an imaginary friend and kills people, but what it's like to try and block out an imaginary friend who's very talkative. But that's just me. But anyway, I think this is a good start. Let's see. Brian wanted me to read something. He's in chat. Matt said to himself. I don't think there's anyone in the room right now, but whatever. We plow on. This has not been a very productive day for me. Alright, segueing rapidly along, let's take a look at Drone Racer by Brian and hope that this is good. If everything seems under control, you're not going fast enough. Mario Andretti. Interesting. So it starts with a laudatory quote. Get that. Exterior. Arena. Night. 2035. Okay. First and foremost, 2035 is not a time of day. You might want to do a title rather than a slug line, because, you know, otherwise you could put anything here. Wow. Right, like, it's hard to understand if you put the information in slug line how it pertains to scene. So, I don't like to put things like dates or times in there. Just do this. Alright. We open on a huge arena in the middle of the Dubai desert. It's race day, and there's an excitement in the air worthy of the Super Bowl. The entire arena is swarmed with reporters and fans. The fans hand over futuristic credit cards to pay for their tickets. Alright, last time we talked about the difference between showing and telling, which is illustrating. And, right now, you're opening in the future, and you're telling me that it's in the future. However, ideally you'd want to show me that it's the future, right? So this is a pretty good effort and an illustration, except I've got no idea what a futuristic credit card looks like. Like, are they even rectangles? I mean, it's 19 years in the future. Do they still even have credit cards? Do they pay with their phone? Like, it could be as simple as As they walk up to the cashier, a retina scanner scans their retinas, and then deducts from a credit card in their wallet, you know, or something like that. Or even a human-dog clone hybrid walks through the door or reports on things. But what I would suggest is, given... given that a paragraph, like... For example, like you could have a reporter land in a flying news van, and then when we see, oh my gosh, that's a flying news van, those don't really exist, you know, then you could just do title Dubai 2035, or, you know, super if you want. A confident bookie, Dusty Richards, late 40s, perpetually grinning with a slight hint of man on the... I like to introduce, when you're introducing a character, I like to introduce a name first. Dusty Richards, a confident bookie. I'm having keyboard issues again. Takes bets on a razor-thin tablet, and I like to sort of introduce the who, the basic elements of the character description. Dusty Richards, a confident bookie, takes bets on a razor-thin tablet. Because if you include all these little clauses in there, it becomes hard to keep track of how the sentence began. But now we know that Dusty Richards, 40s, a confident bookie, who he is, takes bets on a razor-thin tablet. Then we might want to, the crowd seems... is confident. And then you might want to, now that you've established that Dusty Richards is an object, you might want to ascribe traits to the object in the next sentence. A bookie takes, Dusty Richards, 40s, a bookie, takes bets on a razor-thin tablet. He is confident, perpetually grinning, with the slightest hint of malice in his eyes. The crowd seems to get even loud. The crowd grows louder. And then we get the gambler talking about stuff. Let's see. Give me $1,000 on White Lightning. I'll double that. 10 grand on Red Death. Two spectators chat in the bag. Chat in the background. I hear Red Death's got this in the bag. Now, are you kidding me? Miyashi races circles around that kid. You know what they say about him, though. I mean, they almost disqualified him for cheating last year, hacking visors and all that. Miyashi's screwed. Come on, all that sabotage crap? Probably just a scare tactic. The whole league's corrupt anyway. Ain't that right, Dusty? Well, I can't speak for the inner dealings of the suits upstairs, but why don't you put some cash on Red, just to be sure? After all, it's better safe than sorry. Alright, this is a very strong example of showing, not telling. Right now you're just talking about all this stuff, and you're implying a very interesting story, but you're not actually telling it. You're just sort of blankly putting it out there. For example, it would be the difference between someone saying, I had an interesting experience in the war, versus, like, you know, actually going into the granular details of that story. It was 1977, and I was humping it through the Hanoi, Hilton, or whatever people. Well, if it comes next, why isn't it here right now? Like, why do I need this information said? I mean, alright, if we skip ahead to when they actually do interesting stuff. Like, I'm much more interested in John Miyashi going through the pre-race ritual than I am having it explained. Like, let me show you why this isn't a great thing. Like, you just wouldn't want to keep explaining this, because rather than just have people talk about drone racing, why don't you just open up with drone racing? Alright, so we cut from the hubbub outside the arena, where a lot of exposition is dropped, to the locker room, where John Miyashi prepares for a race in a tranquil, easygoing kind of way. He gets a call from his son, and his white wife, who wish them luck. And we're really talking about Red Death some more. I don't know. Alright, my problem here is we're on page 7, and we keep talking about these pods. And why don't we just get all of this information off to the races on the first 3 pages? The way you do something like that is you just make it a little bit more immediate. How do you do this? Original author in chat says, I'm not sure how to get there that fast. Well, the trick here is we want to cut to the first time the script actually gets interesting. Alright, so now we got high-tech wrenches and laptops, making quick adjustments to the software. We got these in the locker room. Red Death, I don't trust him. Do-do-do-do-do-do. He might have messed with your goggles. Alright, some very unsettled foreshadowing. Oh my god, it takes so long to. Here, we just go here. The way you get to that this immediately is you just cut this information. To the beginning. All right, so this the major problem we got here is it's too much talk, not enough action. We open on a huge arena in the middle of a Dubai desert. It's race day, and there's an excitement in the air worthy of the Super Bowl. The arena is swarmed with reporters and fans alike. They're all fighting to get in the doors. Bookie takes bets outside. Then we cut to inside, which would be. And the reason why we're doing this is we'd want to describe the sport immediately. All right. So you've described an arena, right? Now we got to describe a drone, and we got to skip ahead to what the description of the drone is. Where is it? James enters the pit, a row of futuristic pods, various high-tech drones, each 4 feet long, with giant rotors and futuristic laser turrets mounted in the front, are mounted. So let's describe this. Alright, the other thing is, what is the difference between a pod and a drone? Because I have, I am not sure what the difference between a pod and a drone is, and my tolerance for sci-fi bullshit is very low today. So this isn't, again, showing not telling, because we could make this interesting. Rather than several drones whiz by at high speed, we could actually just create a story here. Where's my button? Like, the red drone swerves by, you know, gains an advantage in the point. We see the relief on the pilot's face. But oh no, the blue drone is coming in from behind. Pew, pew, pew! He shoots at the red drone with his lasers. Thinking quickly, the pilot in the red drone takes evasive action and drops a cloud of floating electromagnetic mines behind him. Blue is forced to careen to the side to avoid the cloud of death. He almost hits a canyon wall, but skillfully regains as Red circles back behind him. Red grins as the tables are turned. And then, but just when it looks like Red is going to triumph over Blue, more Red team comes in, and we actually get a sense of the game. Because right now you're talking about a sport, and I don't want to hear a build-up to a sport. For example, if this were a football movie, we wouldn't have two kids standing outside of a stadium saying, "Oh my gosh, can you believe Tom Brady is again playing in the football game? Yes, I cannot believe Tom Brady, a skillful quarterback, is still playing at his advanced age. But the other team better watch out, because I hear there was a Deflategate. Yes, now let us go into the stadium." Then we cut to the football arena, where Tom Brady is sitting alone and beatific in the locker room. And then he gets a call from Tom Brady Jr., and then he goes out on the field. No, we'd want to see Tom Brady doing interesting stuff on the field, just so we get a sense of what the author's visual take on football is. Top 10 Trivia says, "Good job, Matt." And then he goes on to say, "Ted 2, lol." I'm missing that. Alright, so if the drones are one part obstacle course and one part dogfight, laser beams and missiles fly across the arena as various drones fall and crash to the ground. Alright. The thing here is, if this is about drone racing, no, I clearly get the kid avenging his dad's death, but there's a much cleaner way to do that, which would be... I haven't seen Ted 2. I don't get the joke there. Harder to reveal it's a drone fight, you know. And then we see the interplay between the drones. Given that you're inventing an imaginary sport here, we should see enough of the sport to get an idea of how it works, how one scores, what, if anything, is illegal. Intro John, heroic. He's about to win a match over bad guy, but then cheating. Oh no, bad guy is using bad stuff. Manuel Valenzuela says, "Did we just start?" We've been on for about 30 minutes. If you got something you want me looking at, John crashes and burns. Cut to. Int, John's house. Yeah. Day. Or cut to. Audience. John's son watches from the stands, horrified. And then we cut to 10 years later. The son, now a man, rides a motorcycle, starts a fight, does drugs in Tijuana, showing how the trauma has hurt him. So rather than create like all this unnecessary exposition for, oh my gosh, Red Death's got this thing in the bag, Miyashi races circles around that other racer. You know what they say about him, though. Almost disqualified cheating, hacking visors, and all that crap. What I really want to see is, on the a ship flies through space, describe a dogfight. On the face of a pilot, he wears a jacket that has the same logo of the ship. We're going to think he's inside the ship, but then we pull back to reveal it's not in space after all. It's a drone fight in the middle of Dubai. We see the interplay between the drones. We see enough of the sport to get how it works, how one scores, what, if anything, is illegal. We should also describe the drones and make it very clear how the pods work. But do you see how this would actually start with an amusing image of a drone flying and looking cool, and then a reversal in that image, where we thought initially was a spaceship or a warship, is actually a much smaller thing that is being controlled by someone on the ground. And then you get the game, and then you get the character. He watches his father die. Bam, I'm on board. Well, I don't care if you've never done sci-fi before. It's just, you always want to show, not tell. And if this wasn't sci-fi, there's no way to introduce a football game with 20 minutes of talking about football before finally showing some football. You'd want to start with a cold open that really just nailed your ability to write beautiful football-specific imagery. Same deal here. And then, as cliche as the joke of, or the cut of, I saw my father die and now I ride a motorcycle and gamble in Tijuana is, that immediately shows you that this guy's going to be kind of like a lost soul outsider. But then, in your draft, we got to do a lot of politics, a lot of stuff. And it takes till about, it takes till about 10 pages to actually start what's going on. Whereas you could just do all this interesting stuff up top. Setup is my Achilles heel. Well, that's how you set up faster. If you're ever talking about something, rather than talk about something, just do it. Philip Adams says, what up, Matt-ack? It's either Matt-attack or Matt-ack or a misspelled Matt, but either way, it's nice to have a nickname. I'm doing good. I apologize for not being around yesterday. I'm an idiot. But that is an so this drone attack thing is an example of how to set up from immediacy as opposed to just talking about stuff. And I hope that's helpful. Now, my second thing is, it's so much less interesting to see a drone than it is to see a guy piloting something. For example, there's really no idea. There's really no difference between Robert Downey Jr. being in the Iron Man suit or controlling it remotely from a drone. But somehow, Iron Man becomes much less sexy and immediate if it's not a suit of armor around a character, but rather a remote-controlled device. I don't know why that is. So, my second question is, do these things even need to be drones? I mean, wouldn't it be the exact same movie with much higher stakes if they were actually inside the robots? I don't know. But I think that is a concern worth thinking about, because drones are inherently kind of low stakes. Let's see, I know Philip sent me something the other day, so let's take a look at that. The kid is physically limited, so it's supposed to be like a way of circumventing his physical limitations. Yeah, but to me that's unsatisfactory because, how to put this? If there were a character who were paralyzed, say, and can only move a finger, but really wants to be a race car driver, I would be very unsatisfied if he went to a magical land where race car drivers could be paralyzed because of some magic device. Because it would essentially be saying, paralyzed people are fucked. The only way they could ever live their dreams is if a magic genie put them into a magic world where, rules don't really apply. But what I'd find a lot more interesting is that if this kid were to take real-world technology, like, I don't know, maybe an Oculus Rift or mouse tracking or something, and we found a way to get a kid who can't move to actually drive a race car, and he's really good at it because he has no fear of death. It's much more interesting to see him succeed within something that is A, challenging to him, and B, seemingly outside the realm of possibility, but apparently within the realm of possibility, than it is to see him go to an entire, yeah, like Bran in Game of Thrones. So it would be much more interesting to see a paralyzed kid drive NASCAR somehow, and I'd want to know what sort of device made that happen, than see a paralyzed kid drive a neural net NASCAR or play a video game NASCAR, because that seems less impressive because he's not. You're not allowing him to succeed on. You're not allowing him to be an underdog. You're actually giving him a sport where he's not an underdog. And I feel like if you're going to give someone a physical disability, I'm much more interested in seeing a kid who can't walk right become a knight than I am seeing a kid who can't walk very well becoming a high commander, because a high commander is a cerebral job and a knight is something that feels like the deck is already stacked against him based on his disability. So let's see, where's Philip's thing? I know you sent me something. Yeah, there's this whole thing about how the drones are controlled with a brain interface. The pilots, when linked, can face death. Well, yeah, I get that, but you know what's a lot more interesting than if I die while I'm linked into the interface and my drone dies, I die? Being inside the drone. His dad gets messed with and he dies of what's essentially an aneurysm. Well, to me, that's a much fancier way of saying Red Death cut my father's brake line, so he slammed into a pylon and died. And given that that's immediately identifiable, I'm not sure what setting up the mechanism of the pod helmet visor blah 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 actually buys you. All right, let's take a look at Cobra 2 by Philip. Yeah, physical stakes indeed, because even if you die remotely while piloting, I don't know, a robot, it's much more interesting that the pilots were inside the Jaegers in Pacific Rim than it would be if they were controlling him from back home. And we like it when people ha characters have skin in the game. And even though technically saying that if you die in the Matrix, you die in real life is a way of putting skin in the game, it's the most abstract way of putting skin in the game. I was wondering if you had some time to do mine. Yeah, let me take a look at a pages of Phillips, and then what's yours again? Have you sent me the link? What's it called? It's a crime film. When did you send that to me, Top 10 Trivia? Crime in the City. Yes, hang on. I belatedly realize I've been talking about, I've been talking about getting a new computer for about 2 weeks now, and I just haven't gotten around to doing it. So, that's not good. But I've really been, I've really been meaning to get a new computer. I'm also not sure if I should wait until after some Mac convention where they might announce a new MacBook Pro. I don't know. I've got bad luck buying computers right before an update. Interior, exterior, highway, 1970 Chevelle SS Knight. I really hate this slug line. Just do X. I feel like I've talked about this before, but just X highway. You describe the highway, then you put the Chevelle on the highway, and then you go to the interior, exterior. A red leather driving glove grips the wheel. We seize Cobra, 20s, feline, good looks, clean shaven focused, lights a cigarette with a Zippo. It starts with desire. The ignition, and it sets your mind on ice. Halfway through, everything is casual cool, but in the end, you got a bitter taste in your mouth, and you wondered why you started in the first place. A gas station just in sight. He crushes a pack of Gold Tiger cigarettes and cuts his lights as he wheels in. Then you want another. Yeah, I like this. I like that by crushing the pack of cigarettes, you've actually tied the speech to what he wants another of. So even though he's probably talking about both cigarettes, but also his approach to life and, the fact that he's having sex with a woman that we learn later on. By framing it on cigarettes, it immediately kills the ambiguity and it goes from just, like beat poetry wankery to he's talking about cigarettes and maybe more. When the cigarette butt hits the asphalt, the orange sparks spell out title drop Cobra. Still like that centered. I feel like you're doing too much micromanaging on what the on what you want the shot to be, and it's you're being so particular with your spacing of elements that I feel like it might be working against yourself. An amber gush of liquid starts to fill a dark metal chamber. We move through the liquid. We exit at a nozzle. Dissolve 2. This should be a colon after dissolve 2, not before dissolve 2, because that looks weird. I do like that sort of early 2000s Requiem Room for a Dream close-up shot. That's cool. Oh, did we not do that? There we go. Sorry about that. So yeah, we should definitely fix exterior highway night. Just plant the Chevelle on the highway. Then you do interior exterior Chevelle. Starts with desire. The ignition sets your mind on ice. Really like the fact that Gold Tiger cigarettes are there. Awesome. Then you want another. Cigarette butt hits asphalt. Orange drops spell out title drop Cobra. Putting the title drop there is just kind of oppressive because it's like it must be a title drop, and people might not understand that it's a title. But given it's sort of working against yourself because you really want to make things look cool, and it's better that Cobra looks cool than it does. Than it is that we understand that it's a title drop or not, because we roughly kind of get it. Cobra. So we get this cool little Requiem for a Dream shot. We put the colon here, not here, where it was. Cobra pumps gas into the Chevelle. He looks out in the distance. High beams pierce the highway. He walks out of the gas station, pulls a wallet out of his back pocket. I don't think you need any of this, because I like the Chevelle gas tank, because it's a mysterious enough shot that if you miss a slug line, you wonder what's going on. And then cutting to this answer cut of, what's going on? Oh, he's pumping gas. So I don't really care about him looking off in the distance. I don't care about high beams piercing the highway. He walks off into the lights of the gas station, pulls the wallet out of his back pocket. Rather than that, just cut to Cobra walks into the gas station. The clerk, pimpled and gimped, looks up from a magazine, Weird Tales by featuring Robert E. Howard. The clerk taps his finger on the counter to punctuate every syllable of the sentence of the price. Alright, I don't understand what controlling pacing means, because for me, that's not a great pace issue. Oh, we're talking about, yeah, that'll be 1970. The clerk, pimpled and gimped, looks up from a magazine, Weird Tales featuring Robert E. Howard. The clerk taps his fingers on the counter to punctuate each syllable of the price. I don't understand this scene. And the reason why I don't is, let me bold everything that could be cut and not hurt the scene at all. The clerk makes sense whether he's pimpled and gimped or an old man. He looks it from a magazine. Weird Tales featuring Robert E. Howard. You know, just looking it from a magazine. The clerk taps his fingers on the counter to punctuate every syllable of the price. That's also cuttable because I don't care how much the gas is at all. Hi, Sagiv. I actually read your script, so if you check the playback, you can see what I said about it. I don't understand why the clerk is saying 1970 that way, even if it's to control the pace. The price of the gas isn't really up, isn't really part of the scene. You could achieve the same thing with a simple line like, because that is the immediate action of the scene. Right? Now, the second thing. It's to express mood by hitting the counter. It's aggravation. Well, then, It's sort of distracting detail because I don't understand why he needs to be aggravated. Well, then he doesn't enter with a smile. The clerk looks up from a magazine as Cobra enters and slides a 20 across the counter, because that's roughly what happens. And it doesn't matter if he's, it doesn't matter if he's reading a magazine or not, or if he's irritated. And for me, I'd have Cobra smile because it's even funnier if, or it's even more. It strikes me as more monstrous if he's willing to smile at someone and make small talk before shooting him in the head. All right. The second thing is, but casts no reflection. That's the kind of thing that requires a little bit more explanation, because he's either standing at an angle where he can look into the mirror but not see himself, or a vampire. But either way, that's distracting. Above the mirror, he handles a huge pair of straight scissors from a single thread of filament like the Sword of Damocles. This is another call-out moment. Okay, great. Cobra's a vampire. Then you want to, you definitely want to frame that clearer. So milk this for one sentence more. I don't understand why the mirror, above the mirror hangs a huge pair of straight scissors. You know, you might want to explain why they're there. For example, Snippy's gas. The, you know, we've been cutting prices since 1970. Cobra slides a 20 over the counter. The clerk goes to grab it, but Cobra holds it too firmly. Let me get a... This is where the clerk might drum his fingers annoyed, because it's annoying when someone is trying to pay you money and then doesn't give it to you. Slides a 20. You should put the dollar sign there. Let me get a pack of Gold Tiger, unfiltered. The clerk eyes him narrowly, but then turns around and looks into the mirror just long enough to watch his face explode. I actually like this. I really do. If it were me, I would probably do. The clerk turns around and, looks in the mirror. Slowly he realizes something's wrong. Cobra is not, casting a reflection. He has just long enough to realize this before, boom, his face explodes. The revolver makes a... heavy sound when it's laid onto the counter. The tiller rings as it opens. Oh my god. Philip, do I look like a man who'd be uncertain of the metaphorical weight of the Sword of Damocles? A metaphor that is so famous it was actually used in a song in Rocky Horror Picture Show. Now, I understand that you put the damn scissors in as a metaphor for impending doom. But what I don't understand is how it's organic to your scene that that metaphor be there in the first place. For example, if I say that a script is like a watch, and I talk about this watch, and I talk about this watch, at a certain point, unless I say something really fucking clever about the watch, it kind of feels like I'm just kind of showing off the fact that I own a watch, and that I spent way too much on, as opposed to actually using it to convey a metaphor. So by the same token, I get that the Sword of Damocles is hanging over this head because he is in danger, but the two problems I have with this is, one, it's not like hanging scissors loom over every workplace. That's weird. Two, I've never seen an ad that looks like this. Even if it were in the 50s, that would be unusual, but you haven't really specified time period. Is this something that's really old? And C, the Sword of Damocles represents the tenuous grasp on power that kings and rulers have. Specifically, the Sword of Damocles appeared when Damocles took a throne, and he realized that he could never rest easy again. So I'm not sure what the clerk at the gas station has to do with this pre-medieval king. My issue with this take is it might be a little too smart. You're really relying on small details of the mirror to convey vampire. And the revolver makes a heavy sound when it's laid onto the counter, the tiller rings as it opened, as it opens. Even though that's sort of implicitly clear that Cobra is setting down the gun because he has shot the clerk. And the tiller rings as it opens. That's just abstract enough that it could lose someone, and people don't like feeling lost. Also, you can't really count on an audience member to hit confusion, pause, say, oh, I see where he's going, and then decode the image that you want him to have. Well, technically, in the first act, you find out he's a vampire because you did that mirror bit. I mean, given that you're willing to show that we're in a magical world where a man walks in and does not cast reflections, why is this benefited? Why does the story benefit by delaying the fact that it's a vampire issue? Also, I feel like by delaying the vampire beat, you're kind of stepping on the really cool hook, which is, what if vampires drove really cool late 60s mid-century cars? I just genuinely like that more than a guy that goes vaguely around citing literary references and encountering clerks who read pulp magazines from the 1930s for some reason. But it's not confusion. I mean, all right. Let's say we're doing a script and Matt, me, is doing a webisode and he's just talking to camera. And then suddenly, boom, Matt grows a second head. You can't just say, and suddenly Matt grows a second head. And then we just continue on, because that would be horrific. You'd want to know what my reaction to having a second head is, and what the second head's reaction to a second head is, and what the chat would look like. Holy fuck, Matt, you just grew a second head. That's bizarre. And it's the same, growing a second head would be sufficiently interesting that people would comment on it. And just as people might comment on me growing a second head abruptly, your script should acknowledge that a man not casting reflection is interesting and vampire-y enough to merit one more comment. Hey guys, show of hands, who immediately knows who Robert E. Howard is and knows that the knowledge of Robert E. Howard sets us in a pulp story? You know what also tells us that we're in a pulp story? That a macho guy is doing a voiceover about cigarettes wearing red driving gloves. And if you really want to make it pulpy, then the next shot we see a woman in lingerie, on the cover of those Penny Dreadfuls that they sold back in the day. You're using a weird set of symbols. It'd be like me saying, this marker is a symbol for motherhood. As every person knows, a dry erase marker is a universal symbol for motherhood. And hopefully you'd be looking at me askance saying, Matt, are you high? Since when are markers a symbol for motherhood or any sort of familial relationship? And I could say, well, in my mind it's a symbol, but if it's not a universal symbol, markers are not going to mean what I think they mean. So, if your intention is to show that you're in a pulp novel, I think there are better cues to show, and also the idea of pulp novels in general, not widely accepted, so you're kind of writing for a very limited reference pool. You're good to disagree, but you've asked for my opinion. Take Manuel's Valenzuela's comment, I love that idea. The idea of vampires driving really cool 60s cars like the man from Uncle is really cool. However, what's interesting about this is not present until we actually had this conversation. Feminine hands in iridescent milky bathwater with long matte ivory. Montage. Feminine hands in iridescent milky bathwater with long matte ivory. Feminine hands in iridescent milky bathwater with long matte ivory fingernail polish, each with a gilded gold skull in the center. This is just a little rule I like to do. Set the context first, then do the traits. Feminine hands glide through milky bathwater. This way, you understand what you're describing before you go through so many clauses describing, and it cuts some space. Full lip smack with thick pink gloss, iridescent bubbles whirlpool down a drain as toes rub together. A perfect blue eye is painted below the cuticle on every toe. Cool. Alright, way too much jewelry stuff. I think you could cut three elements out of this and it would still work. This is a really cool story. I really still really like the visuals, but you got a tendency to really shoehorn in cleverness, and that can yield diminishing returns, because I don't think the Robert E. Howard thing is going to translate universally what you want it to translate, and I feel like it reeks of cleverness, and you never want to look like you're working too hard to be clever. Because when you're doing that and it doesn't work, it's like somebody who's like coming out and is desperate to be funny and just isn't. That's okay. I'm interested in how my characters sound to you. My biggest weakness is dialogue. All right. Well, it's simple. Here's a little trick for understanding how characters sound. You just go to reports, character report, and let's take a look at how the dialogue sounds. Cobra speaks 11 times, 25%, for a total of 329 words, 37% of all dialogue. Cobra interacts most with Coco. Cobra has monologues on the following pages. 10. Alright, so we'd go through this and we'd look at this. We zoom. Alright, so we got our tough guy monologue on page 1. Here you go. Let me get a pack of Gold Tiger filter on cigarette. Here you go is a line that tells me absolutely nothing about the character. I would much rather see Cobra, sliding a $20 bill across the counter. Let me get a pack of Gold Tiger unfiltered. Scorpion, remember me? I never knew what was going on with you, and that was frustrating as fuck. Your mind was like black ink on black paper. Invisible, untraceable. I feel like this could be cut because I get the metaphor. If you got to keep selling the metaphor, you're not selling it super well. Sometimes when I'm alone, I'm pretending you're in the next room over. I rehearse all the conversations we'll never have, talking to air. Now, you were like dad that way. You weren't for everybody, but you were for me. This could be cut in half. Could probably cut all this. Sometimes when I'm alone, I pretend you're in the next room over. Rehearse all the conversations we'll never have. Know that they'll pay. Their children will pay. Their friends will pay. And gets us to the point faster. Cobra, now he's saying something in French. Coco, you get what I asked for? Coco, did you? You know how important it is to me. I spoke to you about it at length. Oh, Coco, little rabbit. I never doubted you for a single second. Neither of these are exactly selling the idea of Cobra as a tough guy, or in any way seem like a really cool undead murderer who drives a 1967 car. What's a dollar going to buy you, N-word? A deranged happiness gnawing on bath salts? Your dick gummed by a toothless S-word? Or candy to lure little boys to slick your F-word? I struggle to think of an actor who could read a line like that with a straight face. Yeah, why? That's sort of a generic line that tells us nothing but Now Cobra's monologuing again. The darkness gathers, vapor by vapor, choice by choice, until tendrils are inescapable. What I don't understand is why Cobra sort of behaves like a 1960s greaser punk from a 50s bad movie, and yet in his inner monologue talks like a character in a Vertigo comic. So yeah, if you look through Cobra's 37 lines of dialogue, or 11 lines of dialogue, there's actually very little in here that is really unforgettable or interesting or even specific to Cobra. Like, there's very little here that Nigel couldn't say. So there's sort of a sameness of the character, and he doesn't really shine. The other thing that this exercise shows is that when you strip away Cobra's potentially cool visuals, like his dialogue doesn't really show him in the best spotlight. All right, let's see if Top 10 Trivia actually sent anything. Top 10, you here? Did you still want me to look at that? If you're not here, I'm not going to look at this. All right, well, we're waiting for Top 10 Trivia to chime in. Let's do this on Wolf and Jekyll. Yeah, the character report tool is really useful because it immediately identifies dialogue that doesn't work. Can't see the screen, we're back on that. Where'd my character report go? Let's try Jekyll. This motherfucker a snake. You heard what he did to All-Star Taylor? All-Star Taylor with his star tats going up his arms? You know All-Star. That's right, he made All-Star a watch as he fed his kids to that fucking Doberman. Oh, he did. I saw the video on All-Star's phone the night we took care of his brother. Wolf, you could hardly hear anything over that crazy bitch's laughing, but what stuck with me, look. I've done a lot of fucked up shit, but when he made Taylor scream, fuck you to his kids as they cried out to him. Jekyll, he cocks the gun. Alright, so that's that. Jekyll, I mean, at least he's got a character. It's a little soft. Because he alternates between, like, sort of a generic street patois, which I'm not terribly convinced by, and also the, look, man, I know I'm a tough guy, but even I, a tough guy, have some moral limits, which then frames what the guy I'm talking about, why he's more monstrous, you know, so I'm really a Greek chorus is establishing how fucked up the man in question is. So fucked up. So, it's sort of a one-note character. Let's see what Wolf is up to. Yeah. Didn't that punk wait in his crib with his kids, a dog, and a 45? I heard that he held their hands as a dog tore the meat from their bones. You ready to do this? Oh, I'm gonna enjoy this shit right here, Jack. So, yeah, these characters read a little bit generic. What I find interesting is that when you're establishing details visually on characters, they're actually very interesting. You know, to the point where, you know, you're willing to fight me over why the clerk absolutely needs to be gimped and pimpled and to have a Ron How- or a Robert E. Howard magazine. But that level of visual spark doesn't really translate to your dialogue. So I guess the question for you would be, how can you find ways to translate your visual emotion to dialogue, which is auditory? And I guess I would suggest using more colorful language, language that conveys an image. So yeah, that's how you look at dialogue. So what I'd suggest is... look at my blog, www.thestorycoach.net, and Google a term, characters are patterns. I got a little exercise in there that, any tips? Yeah, Google my blog for characters are patterns, and it'll be a little easier. All right, let me jump back to my main screen. Remind me to... jump back, and let's close out this little webisode, which has gone better than I thought it would. check out Stavros's thing. Oh, also, one more thing. So let's take a look at Crime in the City by Stavros Metsoupolis. Crime in the City by Stavros Metsoupolis. Exterior, restaurant, night. A luxury restaurant in the heart of New York City. An old man, around 5'5", 250 pounds, clean-shaven in his mid-50s, wearing an expensive suit, way too much description, is walking out of the restaurant. Next to him are a 5'6 blonde model wearing a casual black dress. They are walking to the car. Okay. We suddenly see a guy dressed in a black suit watching them. He gets out of the car and starts following them. Matt, I guess that's a character. Manuel Valenza says, I wonder if the audience will be better on YouTube. I feel like Twitch is more active. The girl is screaming as she is shocked. Mac grabs her by the hand. Shut the fuck up, and or you will be next. The girl agrees and leaves. While the girl is running, the guy on the floor shoots Matt with his leg. Matt falls back down, then he quickly shoots back, killing him. Alright, so you already messed up there, so... Alright. A. You've already got way too much description here. Start with a luxury restaurant in the heart of New York City, I get that. Cut this, and just frame it as a mafia type walks out with his way too young girlfriend. Then we got a guy dressed in a black suit. Notice how in this script, in three lines in, we have no character names, we have no real character traits, but we have a really, really good idea of the shopping list for these people. You have a garment shopping list fetish for in your character description, and I wish that would stop, and B, I wonder why. Like, do you work as a buyer in fashion? Because that would actually make sense. Matt shoots the guy in his left shoulder. Rather than he goes down, you might want to stress the guy goes down. And rather than shut the fuck up or you will be next and the girl agrees and leaves, just do the girl runs off screaming, because it precludes a kind of a stupid line. Ah, thanks, Manuel. I appreciate that. While the girl is running, the guy on the floor, he's not on the floor, he's on the ground. Matt falls back down and then quickly shoots back, killing him. That would be better as Matt falls to the ground, but even as he does, he's pulling the trigger. You might want to make that a little more colorful. I'm not sure. The other thing is, I'm not sure if this is a great opening image. Because you could call this generic mob hit scene number 15632. And you kind of, if you're going to use this to sort of lure me into your story, I'd like to see how your take on a crime story is different than someone else's take on a crime story. Philip Adams says, I have a lot of descriptions too. What's a good amount of descriptions, Maddie? You don't want to describe someone past the point of being bored. For example, I like to do something I call the boring, boring, interesting rule. And boring, boring, interesting goes like this. If I say, Mary opens the door to allow a plumber inside. She shows him up to the bathroom. You wouldn't want to just say, the plumber is a big blue-collar guy who's shows his butt crack when he bends over, because that's boring. You know, that's like a stereotypical plumber description. But if I were to say, like, the plumber is a fat blue-collar guy, when he bends over, he shows his coin slot, and he's listening to a Learn Chinese Language tape. Like, he automatically becomes slightly more interesting, because that's not something that you'd expect to come out of a plumber. That's piggybacked onto two boring things about a plumber. So, ultimately, a description should both give an idea of who the character is and contain something interesting for a writer to read, because otherwise they're just handsome, clean-shaven, tough guys with leonine good looks. And, you know, we kind of want to see that, the archetype, plus whatever spin on the archetype you're doing. Sagiv says, Twitch is great, I'll watch regardless of where you stream. Yeah, Twitch is really easy to use. What's a good amount of descriptions? I try not to make it longer than four lines. Because it all breaks down to adjective archetype. I could be a fast-talking nerd, or, you know, a cynical Asian guy, or, you know, a writer with an ever-present vape pen. But how much description? You'd want to... Alright, just as an exercise to wrap this up. You guys pitch me crazy characters, adjective archetype, and I'll, like, write how I introduce them in a script. Manuel says, why does Dave breaks in his description? Is this fine to do? Yeah, I mean, if it's interesting, it's fine to do. This is a little generic because we start with a luxury restaurant, generic mob detail, an old man, fat, generic mob details, expensive suit, generic mob detail, blonde model, there would be an E on blonde, casual black dress, generic mob detail. Guy dressed in a black suit watching them. He gets out of the car and starts following them. Generic detail. Matt is getting close to them. I'm not sure if Matt is the guy following them or the guy following the guy. Shut the fuck up or you'll be next. Generic mob detail. The girl agrees and leaves. Generic mob. So it's all just generic. I'd like to see interesting take on mob detail, but in terms of the white space created, like at least it's clear. I mean, it's not the way I'd write it, but it's not wrong. So if Matt is the hitman who follows them, it should be a little bit more clear from the top. Because Matt shoots the guy could mean Matt shoots a guy who is mid-50s wearing an expensive suit. Or it could be a guy dressed in a black suit watching them. He gets out of the car, starts following, and Matt could be a second character. So it becomes unclear if there's three or four characters described in the scene. And that right there is a big, confusion moment, and I hate being confused. So Philip suggests zombie spirit samurai looking for his lost spirit. Kenshi enters. The porcelain mask of his 1600 samurai armor can't conceal the fact that he's long dead. His posture is always watchful and stiff. Clever Doug, the drug dealer who kills for perversion. Doug enters, showing way too much chest hair and belly fat under the deep-cut leisure suit he wears without a shirt. His chest is half covered in whipped cream. It's just you don't need that much. These characters become interesting through their behavior. Because I could introduce Dougie. And if his first line is, woohoo, party, Sigma Lem, frat brothers forever, he's one kind of dipshit. But if he comes out and ignoring the whip shit completely says, it took seven goes, but your son's finally dead, he's another kind of person. So I think a lot of people try and get too clever with character description. They try and really frame what the audience wants to see and really show off how clever they are and just give me a great character. But the truth is, you can't give me a great character off of like what's essentially one tweet. A great character becomes great because of the decisions he's made. Rick in Casablanca is just as generic 1940s tough guy, you know, tough talking. I drink bourbon and I like dames. And what the reason why we remember him is because this is a man who was once in love and has always fought for the losing side. And as a doomed romantic, his heart was broken. And so he went to Casablanca where he gave up and he never drinks with people. But then the woman of his dreams comes back. And even though he loves her, he realizes he's not the best for her. So selflessly, he gives her up. So, to make the world a better place. And I remember Rick because of what he did. You know, sure, Humphrey Bogart played him, but Humphrey Bogart played a lot of guys in trench coats. So characters become interesting through their behavior, their sacrifices, and their decisions. And all I like to do is to give enough to paint kind of a small mental picture, give them a little bit of behavior. And, you know, there's not much in there, but there's a little pop of interest on both characters. And you'd never mistake Kenchi for Dougie, or vice versa. Any other questions before I wind down and go get a sandwich? Tupton Trivia says the thing is, if you're being too descriptive, you narrow down the people you can cast. Well, yeah, that's why you just describe more the archetype. You know, if you want a girl who's a girl next door type, it doesn't really matter if she's, you know, white or black or, you know, redheaded. And, it, you know, people can dye their hair or change something. Sigiv says, can I ask something about my script? Sure, go nuts. Manuel says, no, great episode. Thank you, Manuel. Really appreciate it. Sigiv, what you got for me? Have a great night. Gonna check your pattern on characters as patterns. Awesome. Sigiv, you've got like 10 more seconds. I know there's a lag. All right, Sigiv, email me. But, guys, thank you so much for watching. I'm sorry about yesterday. I'll be back on schedule next Saturday, 5 p.m. And I may try a Twitch broadcast sometime in the week. Oh no, it's not that I didn't think Sam could be cheerful. It's that you want to show the juxtaposition between cheerful Sam before your teaser and vengeful Sam with the chain around his knuckles. You want to paint that a little more clearly. I understand why Sam was more cheerful. All right. Good times, guys. I will talk to you later. I'll see you next Saturday. And follow me on Twitter. I may try a Twitch experiment sometime during this week. All right. Take care.